There we go. Okay. Thanks everyone for bearing with us as we get started with today's session of our Lunch and Learn. We, you know, are coming straight off of the Growing Vibrant LA Communities session in Spanish, and we're so excited with how that event went both today and yesterday. If you missed the English session, I recommend you look out for the recording for that. But it was bumping right up against our Lunch and Learn today, so we're running a couple minutes behind. So today I'm really fortunate to be able to invite our partners at Google. Let me go ahead and pull up, there we go. So today we're gonna be able to hear from our partners at Google who have been working with us on their Tree Canopy Lab component of the Google Environmental Insights Explorer. This has been a project I was brought on to my second week at the city. I got to meet with the mayor's sustainability team and Google to talk about the possibilities of this tool and understand better their Environmental Insights Explorer tool and how they're using it to support cities in making decisions to meet their climate resilience goals. And this desire to really test out and build a tool around trees specifically and urban forest and urban canopy goals, as the city of LA has these goals to increase tree canopy in our areas of greatest need by 50% by 2028. And so we've been talking at each of our Lunch and Learn events about the four pillars of urban forest management: planting, maintenance, preservation, and engagement. And I've also shared that we have our guiding principles of being deeply rooted in science and utilizing key partnerships. And today we're going to be focusing on that utilizing key partnerships component and having Google share a little bit about their tool. So Austin, I know Ruth is on the East Coast. Ruth is the program manager for Google AI, who's been working closely with us on this. And I know she was having some issues with her internet. I think that they're having some storm issues there. So I don't know if you wanna go ahead and dive in. And so everyone, we're gonna have Google share some information on the tool. We've got some questions that they wanna ask you. And then we're gonna do our typical Q&A at the end where you get to ask questions to myself and the project team. So you can learn more about this resource that we have available to us. So Austin, are you ready to take it away?
I am. I think Ruth was going to intro with some slides, but seems to be having some connectivity trouble. So I can kind of just launch into a demo. We can go into discussion from there. That sounds good.
Well, I'll just give Ruth one shot. Ruth, I see that you're here. Are you able to unmute yourself and do a little intro? Well, if you can, we'll have you do that. If not, let's go ahead, Austin. We'll have you take over and do a demo of the tool.
Can you hear me? Sorry.
We can. There you are. Ruth? Well, we did have her, but Austin, if you want to go ahead and jump in, let's have you take it away.
That sounds good. My audio is cutting in and out a little bit, so if it ends up dropping, I'll just quit the call and rejoin. Let me cast up my screen. It looks like screen sharing is disabled. Is there any way for the host to enable it?
That may be good now. Yeah.
Okay, let me see. Ah, perfect. Okay, can you see the tool?
I can, and Austin, I didn't do a proper introduction. Do you wanna share your role at Google briefly for the folks that are joining us?
Sure thing. My name is Austin Benavides. I'm the tech lead for the Tree Canopy Lab at Google. My name right now on the call is Ruth Alcantara, who is our program manager. For some reason in Zoom, every time I change my name, my audio drops. So I will keep it as Ruth for right now and represent the two of us. Yeah, so we've been chatting with Rachel and team for the past year and a half and change. And over that time, we've been rapidly prototyping, presenting Rachel and team with mocks, a couple of demos over the course of the last year, and iterating rapidly to provide a tree canopy assessment of the city of Los Angeles to help Rachel and team achieve two major goals for the LA Green New Deal. which are planting 90,000 trees by end of 2021 and increasing tree canopy cover by 50% in the most vulnerable areas. And so what's shown on my screen right now is the manifestation of all these conversations we've had over the past year. It's still a work in progress, but this is what we launched mid-November last year. And it's located right now under the Environmental Insect Explorer page. If you go to the hamburger menu on the left, when arriving at this page, and you drop down the labs, you can arrive at this tree canopy lab. And this is what you're presented with. At a high level, this web app is broken into two major components. So on the left side, you'll see a control panel with UI affordances that can be controlled to dictate how the user interacts with the map on the right. And then on the right side, we have a grayscale map of the greater Los Angeles area. The neighborhood council boundaries are drawn in black on this map. And each of the census tracts in the city of Los Angeles are colored from goldenrod yellow, the lower end, indicating about 0% tree canopy cover, to forest green, indicating 30%+ tree canopy cover. And you can see those values shown in the bottom right in the legend, along with a little bit of metadata about the data we use to present this analysis. So this tree canopy cover at a high level, this assessment at a high level was generated by taking really high quality overhead imagery at 25 centimeter resolution, passing RGB imagery along with a height map through a spatial unit. The output of that spatial unit is a probability between 0 and 1, 0 indicating 0% chance that a pixel on the ground is part of a tree canopy, 1 indicating 100% probability that it is part of a tree canopy. We threshold at 50%, so any confidence score of 50% or greater is categorized as tree canopy. And then we compute census tract level aggregates across the city of LA so that at a high level, the user can see how the tree canopy cover is distributed across the city. If the user zooms in, either by zooming with a mouse pad or clicking the plus button here into a particular neighborhood, we will swap these tree canopy cover aggregates for the individual tree canopy footprints across the city. And you can see, zooming in, for example, to 27th Street Historic District, it loads up. It's really quick. Zooming into a particular neighborhood, again, you'll notice that we swap out the census tract level aggregates for the individual tree canopy footprints. And if I zoom in, say, to City West, you'll notice that these tree canopy footprints are located not just in public rights of way and along streets, but also in private spaces and in backyards. And you can see how the areas that we consider to be, that we classify as tree canopy compared to the satellite imagery by going to the top right and swapping out this grayscale map for satellite imagery. And here in the layers tab, you can turn on and off the tree canopy cover and see how it maps against the trees that are presented in the overhead imagery. Swapping back to the grayscale image, we'll zoom out a little bit. Zooming out inversely, we will swap out those individual tree canopy footprints for the census tract level aggregates. In place of the tree canopy cover layer, you can also choose to view some basic socioeconomic factors such as heat health action index, which is a proprietary metric of heat vulnerability built out by the consulting group 427 as part of California's fourth climate change assessment. If you click that option, we will redraw the map showing heat risk across the city. Again, these are census tract level aggregates. And this index is scored 0 to 100, 0 indicating very low probability of, or very low heat risk, 91%+ indicating extremely high heat risk. And this data is drawn from 2018. And you'll notice that, unsurprisingly, there's an inverse correlation between areas with high tree canopy cover and areas with high heat health action index. Similarly, you can swap out the heat health action index for population density and see a similar inverse correlation between tree canopy cover and population density across the city.
Austin, can I ask a quick question? So we have a couple questions coming in that I think would be helpful as part of your presentation. We do have some folks that are familiar with the LIDAR study that was done for LA, which I can just share was done from 2016 LARIAC data that was used by LMU and Tree People and some other consultants to develop this LIDAR map for the region. And there's a question of kind of what the imagery that you have and how it is different from that LIDAR data. And I think the point that is most important to me is the time. So that's 2016 data that the LIDAR study, which was kind of monumental for our work here in LA. What time period are the images that you were pulling from on this tool?
So for the city of Los Angeles, all of these overhead images are drawn from 2018 and 2019. And we'll show that in the bottom right here in the legend. We tend to refresh data for urban clusters in the United States once every 1 to 3 years. And so we have a pretty quick refresh cycle. And the hope is that over time, this tool will be able to show historical trends in addition to the current state of affairs. So instead of just seeing one snapshot for today, you can see how the tree canopy cover for the city has changed over time at that like 1 to 3 year cadence. And then maybe even see like projections into the future. So how am I tracking towards a canopy goal, for example?
Yeah, and I do want to just highlight that because some folks have asked about it, and I think it's a really valid question. We have this really robust tool that was developed by that team, but I really saw this opportunity for us to harness the fact that Google has the engineers and technology to build something like this and be able to do some of those projections of change over time, being able to help us track that through using existing images that they're gathering already for their Google platform. So I think that's really helpful. But if you want to, well, I'll let you keep going, Austin.
Sounds good. And feel free to interrupt with any questions in line, because I think that adds a lot of value to the demo as well. So I switched back to the tree canopy layer from the population density layer. We provide the user with the ability to interact with the displayed map a little bit. So here under the interaction mode dropdown, the user selects draw a polygon. They can draw a bounded region around a group of blocks, say here, clicking to drop a vertex for each corner of the polygon. And we will show a panel in the top right with statistics for the selected area, showing the average tree canopy cover, the heat health action index, which is again, that proprietary like aggregate measure of heat vulnerability or heat risk, the population density for the region, and then also the neighborhood councils that drawn area intersects. And if the drawn area, for example, intersects multiple neighborhood councils, we'll reflect that here.
This is really helpful because I know that with our city at the size and scale it is, even our neighborhood council areas, when you're looking at a tree planting project and you might have a certain area in mind, being able to draw those kinds of boundaries at whatever scale is useful to you with a project or to us when we look at a certain community is going to be great.
Yeah, and we wanted the user to be able to perform this analysis at any granularity they'd want, whether that's at the neighborhood council level or something smaller, maybe the block level or something larger, like half the size of the city. And in addition, zooming back out, we also wanted the user to be able to filter the displayed map based on a set of criteria. And so if you go here to the control panel, you'll notice there's a set of sliders that are used to filter on continuously valued data, like tree canopy cover percentage, heat health action index, population density. And these can be tweaked just to suss out particular regions that might be of a special interest to the city or to planning efforts based on the goals that are set. So go ahead.
I'll add to this. The land use type is, again, another component that I thought would be really helpful for our work because the types of programs that we do for urban forestry vary based on the land use type. So we know the strategies that we need to use in a commercial corridor or commercial area is different than say a single family home, which might have room for private property trees or different attitudes or behaviors towards trees. So we really appreciated Google adding in this data, which again was part of the data sets the city had already available. The heat health action index was, you know, another data set that was already available through the state's fourth climate assessment that was able to kind of, again, look at some of those heat vulnerability characteristics. I'll let you keep going, Austin, but I do want to make sure we have a couple minutes to ask the audience some of the questions that you all had, so.
Yeah, I think we can stop here because this is a pretty effective summary and we can kind of just switch into discussion And if that leads into more discussion about or more demo, we can do that as well.
Great. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to do what we did last time. I'm going to take your screen away, Austin. I'm going to share my screen.
Cool.
And let's see. Yes, I do want to continue. And there we go. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. And guys, we're going to try it again. I have, you see the Environmental Insights Explorer open, but we're going to try another Mentimeter tool. And I'll work on answering a question while you all get there. And this time I've changed the settings. Fingers crossed I did it right. You should be able to go through all the questions. So if you answer the first one, you want to start answering the next one, that's fine. We've got three or four questions that Google asked me to share with you. Do you have any near-term tree planting goals? Would this tool be useful to you? And what are some additional insights that might help you in the future? And actually, Ruth or Austin, could you share a little bit what you mean by insights? So that was one of the questions we have in the deck here. Do you have near-term tree planting goals? We have, I'm not doing a countdown. I'm just gonna scroll through real quick. Will these insights help you in your outreach to communities about your tree planting efforts? Have you used a tool like this before? Maybe the LiDAR tool, have you used that or another tool to look at this kind of data? And then what other insights would you like to see from the tool? And this one was an open-ended question. So you guys can put in as many answers as you'd like. But Ruth or Austin, could you describe what that term insights or what you were really going after with this question? So we make sure we get really good responses.
Definitely. I think with a tool like this, when we are trying to figure out what data to pull into the tool, our goal is not just to inundate the user with as much information as possible, but to present data in a manner that is actionable and goal-oriented. So our hope is that we can pull out correlations between different factors or even start to augment the user's workflow by making suggestions in line that can help inform the work they're doing going forward. So it's really the process of converting a wealth of data into useful information that can then be taken to communicate to stakeholders or like to take action on planting goals.
Yeah, and I think that's the Heat Health Action Index was one that we felt, and the mayor's office also felt would be a really good tool for some of our goals with urban canopy related to heat. It's not exclusively, we want trees for a number of reasons. Heat is one of them. So that's part of the reason that Heat Health Action Index is in there. I do see in the Q&A if we can add a layer for city council districts. And that I think that's some of the initial feedback we've received from city staff, as well as maybe there's a couple other ways that we slice the city other than neighborhood council or census tract. But those were some of our initial conversations with you all is, you know, what data do we include in there? What points do we care about? Population density we included because, again, if we're doing some targeted strategic tree planting, we want to make sure we're putting in those trees potentially where there's additional population or larger population that will be impacted by those trees. We don't limit projects to those areas, but that's some data that's useful to us. But if there's other data that you all would think would be helpful when we're doing tree planting prioritization or urban forestry prioritization, that's helpful. And I'll note here that in the screen share, you can see that on this question, we've got ecological connectivity coming up as one of the options. And that's one that we've actually already talked to Google about. The biodiversity team was part of some of the initial review of this tool. And it may not land on this tool specifically. We've been talking about with Google how some of their interest and resources might be able to support some of our biodiversity connectivity mapping that we're hoping to do in the future. And no decisions yet, but we're definitely engaging with them that conversation. So wonderful to see the community concurring with some city staff thoughts and recommendations. I'm going to scroll back so we can kind of get a sense of what other people have said on the other, as you guys have been madly typing in your answers, I hope. Mm-hmm. Do you have any near-term tree planting goals? We've got one person saying yes, and three not sure, and two not at this time. We have other folks that will these insights from this tool help you in your outreach efforts to your communities? And we've got some of the folks saying yes, and some saying maybe. And I did split this up based on your response to the first question. So the one person who said, yes, we have a tree planting project says, I want to play with the tool a little bit more, which I totally, totally understand. And then have you used similar tools? So four of our participants have, and so far three have not. I'll again, leave the poll questions open so you can keep responding as we kind of continue the conversation. And then the final question, did I have a final question? I also offered a different way, just in case we wanted a different way to say what kind of data would make this tool even more useful. That's kind of a repetition of the first one. So my apologies if that's the case. So you can focus more on this one, whichever one you like the visual of better, maybe. So I'm going to look at the audience Q&A because we do have about 6 more minutes. And Ruth, if there's anything that you wanted to add before I dive into some audience questions, feel free.
Yeah, I'm so sorry. I was having some connectivity issues, but I just wanted to say, again, thank you to Rachel for being a great partner to us as we launch this pilot with LA and really looking at use cases and how this tool can provide insights to the city, to the community. We're still continuing the UX research. Yuling here, who you can see here, is continuing the UX research on how this tool can really be useful to communities as well as the cities. And we're hoping to expand this pilot in the next few months before we expand it more to hundreds of cities. So we really want to help a lot more cities in their climate action goals.
Yeah, I think that's really key. This was the pilot. This was the first version. And when you talk about UX, you're talking about user experience. So that's part of the reason we wanted to do this as part of a lunch and learn, is to get some feedback from you all about how to maybe improve the tool in those ways, as LA is being really the testing ground for this, with the potential to roll out to other cities, since many of them had also asked for support in urban forestry analysis. Austin, I'm going to address this question to you because I think you're the right person to answer it. Can you just remind us of the scale of the resolution on the Insights Explorer tool? What's the resolution? We got at least one technical person on the call today.
For sure. This is quarter meter data. So every pixel that we categorize on the map is 25 centimeters by 25 centimeters.
Great. I hope that answers your question, Eric. I've got another one that's a city council district boundaries are mobile. CD4 and CD5, for example, may soon be modified. Can the data you're collecting be expressed in multiple ways? I think I'll answer that one saying yes. Again, right now we have neighborhood council boundaries and census tracts that are currently available on the map. And we did have a request in the Q&A. Someone was asking if we could do city council districts, but I think that's another reason the tool to draw your own boundaries was really important, is that it allows us to kind of look at different scales, even if it's not currently an option on the Google interface right now. Let's see. I'm gonna scroll through the questions. Does this only work on streets, or can it be used in parks? Absolutely. Can be used in streets or parks. The imagery is capturing trees. It actually doesn't know our boundaries. That was one of the questions one of our staff had, is in some of the early conversations, could you somehow identify where is public right of way versus private property? And we didn't have a good data set at that point to do that, but regardless, it's capturing all the trees, private, public, parks, et cetera. I think that isn't all the questions. I'm just reading, guys, because I didn't log some of the ones I'd answered. How is the tree canopy footprint determined? Not every tree is equal. For example, palms provide no canopy. Austin, are you able to speak to that a little bit? Again, this is gives us a rough snapshot of, and potentially that change over time is what I'm really interested in. But can you answer that a little bit?
Yeah, this is a great question. So I alluded to this a little bit before, but didn't describe in much detail. So we use a machine learning approach that uses state-of-the-art computer vision techniques. The machine learning model we use is a custom U-net. And basically it takes as input two things. So it takes as input that 25 centimeter resolution RGB overhead data, and it takes a depth map, which basically describes the distance from the sensor from the overhead camera down to the point that reflects the light back up to it. So we don't hard code any specific attributes that categorize something as tree or not tree, but this unit is trained on a set of test data to recognize over time what types of features correspond to trees and which ones correspond to other types of vegetation or impervious surfaces. We recognize that the canopy size will differ quite a bit across trees, but this unit takes into account that, you know, that colored overhead imagery in order to basically segment the image into this is canopy, this is not. So the tree canopy footprint for a palm tree displayed on the map will be significantly smaller than a live oak, for example.
Hopefully great. And with that, I've got another question is, is it possible it will pick up trees in planters or on roofs or green roofs? Is there a chance that we're picking up other vegetation?
So the answer is yes. Right now, one of the things that's taken into account is the distance from the top of the tree to whatever flat surface lies below it. So we can actually infer not only where tree canopy is present, but also what the height of that tree canopy stand or tree stand is. So we don't have particular tuning for trees on green roofs or in elevated spaces, but should be able to pick this up as well.
Yeah, and no one was expecting this tool to do everything, but it definitely, again, was this goal. How do we start playing with this data? How do we utilize your expertise in AI, in doing this kind of imagery? And how do we kind of build on that? And I will acknowledge there are other, urban tree canopy projects that are happening. I want more partners at the table. So if we can utilize different resources and expertise, I think the things just continue to get better. We have some other questions. I do want to just acknowledge, so please feel free to continue writing your ideas in the chat. If you have a neighborhood council planting project where you would be interested in playing with using the Google Insights Explorer for your engagement with your neighborhood, you know, this is why we're prioritizing tree planting. This is, you know, if it's a tool that you think you might use for that, please feel free to email me. I think everyone knows my email address, but it's every city and it's city one is first name dot last name, rachel.malarich@lacity.org. And let me know so that we can maybe connect you with the Google team. If you are planning to use it for a project, I think we want some specific feedback from users aside from the city users. If there's use to our neighborhood council groups or community groups or community members, we want to get some additional feedback as we build out, as Google works on the next iteration of this tool and really improving it as they go to scale with other cities. I will probably take some of these questions and find a way to incorporate them into our next session, work with Google to get some answers since we are at time. I really appreciate their Austin and Ruth, I really appreciate you making the time to come and chat with us and kind of give this brief overview. I really encourage people to explore the tool so that we can continue getting feedback and maybe we'll have you back in a bit when we have the next version, so that we can share kind of where we're going, or you can give me some notes and I'll be able to bring back information to you all. So thanks everyone for joining us. And thank you for participating again in this, using the Mentimeter tool to get some of the information on your thoughts and feelings about this tool and how you might use it. I really appreciate the thoughtful questions, which again, will likely include some answers either in the blog or in the next session. So hope to see you guys again soon. And
thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks for inviting us.
Of course, they fun project to work on for sure. Great partners. And we'll see everybody at the fourth Wednesday of the month will be the next Lunch and Learn session. Fourth Wednesday at 12:30. Thanks everybody.